/x/. I've been itching to spill my possibly paranoid theories regarding the area in which I used to work, East Yorkshire, specifically, the Holderness Coast. The place is very rural, cut off from the rest of country, seriously, no one passes through, and isolated socially due to a number of features, notably the thick accent with traces of Old Norse that's pretty much incomprehensible to outsiders. My work was in the logging trade. 6 days a week I'd get up at 4 a.m., journey out of the only major urban center, Hull, which coincidentally, isn't that bad, to a wood farm, cut and bag up logs and kindling, load up my dirty white van and run out deliveries to all the country folk who still think coal and coke are the only way to heat a bath. During my 12 years in this trade I ran into a lot of unsettling things, overheard strange ramblings and witnessed a few suspicious things. Secondly, and this is well documented, the region has a nasty history regarding missing persons and child abuse. My mother, who was a social worker in the city, often talked of uncooperative police officers, pedophile rings and institutionalized abuse in care homes. So anyway, I moved a few weeks ago, and have only recently started to be comfortable talking about the things I suspect. Whilst it is suspicion, I could never shake the feeling that there was some superstructure type thing that I didn't know about, and regardless of whether 90% of the things I am about to divulge are wrong, there's still the 7 people missing a day statistic, heroin-filled seaside towns and pedophile rings. Pick-related, Mapleton's Church, a hamlet I detested, too small, locals too sly. The original was torn down in the 1850s, I think. My grandfather told me a few old wives' tales, as he called them, regarding the reason for its tearing down. The original structure goes back to at least 1100. Firstly, the old wives' tale my grandfather used to tell me about the church. In the mid-19th century, Hornsey, a nearby seaside town, now filled with heroin, was very popular with factory workers from Hull. The story goes that the congregation used to kidnap kids from the town, bring them a few miles down the coast to Mapleton and, well, you know, do spooky stuff to them. He never said what, but left it to my imagination. After a shipwreck near the hamlet, and the murders of the survivors got out when the port authorities came looking for the goods, they found the graves of the kids took from Hornsey beneath the floors of the old medieval church. They tore it down, and rebuilt it. Don't know anything about what happened to those involved, he never claimed to know. But I now think the whole tale isn't too far from the truth. One incident sticks out, or rather, a collection of events, that leads me to believe child kidnapping is still a pastime for those backward fucks. Should have made it clear, the congregation of Mapleton's Church. In the late 1990s when I had just started in the wood trade, Mapleton used to be 3 makeshift shacks on some land behind some terrace houses in the sea. I delivered to one house here, an old woman called Deidre, though she was known to me, and locally as the witch, and Deidre was a heinously ugly woman. The nose, the warts, even on the nose cack, wrinkles, rotting teeth, the works. No idea how old she was, but she could have been 50 to 90, poor people age quickly. The other 2 shacks belonged to her sons, whom I, nor anyone else, claimed to ever see. Her shack was standard wood, salvaged PVC windows and corrugated thing. Covered in dirt, and at least an inch of soot. During the year in question a couple of kids had gone missing in one of the villages round the area, not a lot of fuss was made, parents were junkies apparently, so it's not like it mattered to anyone. During my rounds in the village I overheard a conversation on my way into the back garden of one of the houses, very softly on the wind mind, so I could be mistaken. But it went along the lines of the witch never asked us. When I entered the back garden, I greeted my customer, old dirty fat guy, toothless, etc. etc. and a farmer I haven't seen before then. I asked them the standard question, been up to oat or note? Translation, what have you been up to dear sir? To which the customer replied, laughing, Luke in Thurwat's mind trans, looking for what is rightfully mine, my good old chap. I asked whether the witch had something to do with it, he was startled by this, and the mood became a bit aggressive. Needless to say, I left it at that. I continue to the witch's shack, and knock on her door thing. No answer, knock loudly, no answer. So I leave it, cursing her for making me lug heavy bags of coal for no reason. The farmer I worked for, old Happy Mike Gray, pro tip, he was a miserable sod, was quite the Jew with regards to currency, so he was distressed to not have got the pennies he was entitled to from the old witch and sent me back the next day. This time she answers, she blocks the door and tells me she'll take the bags of coal in. Obviously she can carry bags of coal, so I insist, been polite and whatnot. Instead of the cheery thanks for my niceness, she just huffs and puffs and lets me in. However, there were tiny handprints on the doorframe leading to the adjoining room, and traces of tiny footprints where the floor hadn't been traversed as regularly. Obviously I put two and two together, act as if I didn't notice jack shit and promptly made my way to the post office to gather intel. The post office is the hub of social life in rural villages. I ask whether they'd seen the witch coming and going the past few days. The sub-post mistress winks at me, no shit, and says I, but us'll take care o' dat, translation, affirmative old bean, but I'll see that your inquiry is acted upon. She made no effort to appear ignorant of what I was obviously hinting at. I mentioned the tiny handprints in the soot, but she just acted so. Well, she didn't seem to care that I would suspect her complicity in this thing. I ring the police helpline for the case of missing kids, and tell them what I saw. They promise to follow up my report and treat me a bit like a fool. I start dreading go back to her shack the following week, but I didn't have to. A big storm hit the coast during the week. Coastal erosion is a massive thing on the coast, it loses a meter a year, and during storms it's not unheard of for 10 plus meters to slip into the sea, and when I go back to Mapleton, drive onto the land where the shack's where I see nothing. The witch's shack obviously fell into the sea, but her son's shacks, which were further forward, were gone as well. I can see the shitty concrete flooring from where her son's shacks used to stand. I go to the post office again. There's also like nowhere else to go in Mapleton, barring the cliffs, and ask about her, in sea, translation, in the sea, chum. Ask about her sons, she just tells me they've gone with her. I'm pretty peeved now, cause she's obviously lying. I mention the concrete floors, she just laughs me away saying I'm a cheeky mare. I feel the atmosphere change to one of aggression again, and leave. So at the time I'm really confused by it all. I carry on my rounds. The final house I delivered to in the village was one of the terraces which overlooked the land the witch's shacks were on. As I'm taking the logs into the front room I see, in the kitchen, one of those mega block pirate ships. This old guy, who swore like a sailor, had no family or friends that I knew of, was not spending his spare time playing with a kid's toy. Obviously the villagers knew that the kids were nearby, or someone's kids were nearby, and they obviously used the storm as cover to get back at the witch for what presumed to be her taking a kid without their permission. Sounds far-fetched, and I'd agree with you. But the people, and the general atmosphere of the town, plus the subtle clues I picked up, or just wanted to pick up, leads me to think otherwise. I pushed the whole cursed fortnight to the back of my head, took comfort in the fact I'd reported what I saw to the authorities and carried on as usual. I try and make light of it now, but it still really gets to me. Moving city, I'm in Aberdeen now, has improved my way of coping with that, and the other things I've noted. But anyhow, that's one of the more stark obvious nasty shit things I've been a witness to. More to follow, though not necessarily as major. Thanks to those of you who are reading this, it's nice to get it all off my chest and stuff. So I've made it pretty clear that I think a lot of the rural folk around the area used to kidnap / abuse kids. I'll now detail a few other things that aren't really super creepy but that just kinda stood out as odd. In one hamlet even smaller than Mapleton called Rise there was a primary school, not unusual in the country. But it was derelict and other schools, larger schools in the area existed. I'd usually get there quite late as it was on my route back to the wood farm about 4 p.m. in the day for me and I would always arrive with an old school bus like a converted van thing waiting outside the school. Old guy in the driver's seat, no children in the van, no lights on in the derelict school. He'd just sit there in the van, idling. Sometimes, if I was delayed, I'd see him drive off. Still no kids in it. Never sat well with me. Why was he there? Every week? Huh. An old lady in another village, I forget its name, apologies, had a nasty tumor on her face. Seriously, she was called Mrs. Macaskill. She was very small and had mannerisms akin to crow, very nasty eyes, and face, ha ha ha, cancer face, and very twitchy and sharp in her movements. The thing that bugged me about her was she had three chains bolted to the exterior of her house's back wall, placed about 4 foot up, attached to leather neck straps. The wall was stained with grime, I reckon it was shit and piss. She didn't have any pets, no idea why she had those chains there, none whatsoever. This memory is very hazy, as it's coming from my childhood. I got into the wood business via my grandfather. I used to travel along with him most weekends as a kid. I used to deliver it to the village when I was older, it's called Halsham. I remember a young looking guy opening the van door whilst I waited for my grandfather to drop off some kindling. He leant over the driver's seat and reached out for me, then it gets hazy. I vaguely remember my grandfather having it out with the kid verbally, and me having to go with him to a village hall and sit in some dude's office with the young guy. Like I say, it's a hazy memory, I don't remember much but crying a lot. Ruse, a collection of several large mansion type things, had one guy who had no fingertips. Nice enough to me, but he had the type of land filled with rusted cars, and he had a son with serious learning difficulties who looked like he had fetal alcohol syndrome. What was sinister was his son been caught fondling a little girl on some abandoned land north of Hull. It was in the local rag, and the topic was obviously broached by me on one of my deliveries. The guy with no fingertips was quite adamant he didn't do anything wrong. When I mentioned he might get away with a lenient sentence because of his fetal alcohol syndrome, he looked offended and told me in no uncertain terms he was a normal healthy kid. He wasn't. I replied if he didn't have health issues he did something quite wrong, yet he still remained adamant it was fine. Something about country folk not being pansies and taking what they're entitled to. I left it at that, remembering the Mapleton episode. On top of those relatively minor things, I used to see quite regularly lights in the wooded areas during winter when it got dark early. Was so regular it never struck me as odd until I saw a couple of men walking out of a wooded area in front of me with shovels across the road into a farmer's yard. Again, nothing on its own, but with the culmination of the atmosphere and shit it did make me wonder. Another customer, from Old Ellerby, used to give me homemade preserve on the longest and shortest days of the year. She always promised me her special jam with a wink. Needless to say that preserve was always thrown away when I got home. Thanks for the feedback guys, makes me feel like I'm not in an echo chamber haha. Next up I'll tell you about the shit my mom used to talk about before she passed. She was abused as a kid and adopted when she was 8, so she'd seen shit, but she was incredibly strong and pursued her career as a social worker rapidly. It kind of destroyed her health and she died relatively young at 52. There's a lane on the outskirts of Hull, technically in a village called Cottingham which is notorious for the murders carried out down it, it's called rather aptly Snuffmill Lane. The most recent murder down there was about 3 years back. Some poor sap got jumped by two lowlifes with baseball bats and was pretty unrecognizable from what I heard. So but anyways, I digress. In the 60s, when my mum was still a teenager, a 6-year-old boy was found rolled up in a carpet. He'd been tortured, raped and starved. Basically he'd been kept as a plaything, finished off with a knife and dumped. Not too unusual sadly, but my mom always maintained that the reason why there was little to no investigation was because of Hull's pedophile ring, which reportedly contained senior police officers, judges and counselors. She maintained till the day she died that it still existed, and I believe her. Not just because I respected and trusted her word, but because in the past decade or so more and more senior members of Hull's social and legal elite have been outed and prosecuted as pedophiles. Never whilst they were in office or anything mind. Google Humberside police chief and pedophile. Do the same for counselor. However, the kid wrapped up in a carpet in the 60s, nothing on the net about him. Never been able to find shit. Make of that what you will. Next, I'll repost the stuff about Langthorpe Hall, which is up there with Mapleton in terms of how it makes me feel, plus extra stuff on what I reckon is going on. I made the city a screen cap wall of text thing cause word limit kills me. So I mentioned in the pic that Charlie inherited the estate fairly young and had to see to its business. I rang him yesterday to ask more about it since he sold up, and he was surprisingly forthcoming regarding some details. His mom and dad both used to attend church in New Ellerby on a Wednesday, late night. He reckons they were part of some extreme Christian cult thing. Regarding the tunnels, he said he knew as little as me, but did say that one of the conditions of his running the estate was to allow the people staying in cottages access to the basement. Says he didn't ever see them use it, but then again, he wasn't there regularly. Still won't tell me about the horse incident and got upset when I mentioned it, don't blame him. We haven't been close in reality for a long time, more residual platonic love left over from the past, so I don't think I'll ever find out the truth about that incident. To be honest, it was pretty exhausting talking to him about these things, couldn't get the idea of those missing kids out of my head the whole time. Pick is looking east towards Langthorpe Hall. The house itself was freaky at night, and I often used to see faces at the big Georgian windows. But your brain does shit like that when you're already wigged out at night and you look into pure darkness. This incident occurred when I was 18. Charlie's mom was on holiday, but he wasn't allowed keys to his home at this point. We had a party which was busted by the people from the cottages who just let themselves in at 2 a.m. or something ridiculous like that. We just chilled and smoked in the fields. We often found chewed up rabbits and wood pigeons, not unusual. But on this night we were being extra stealthy, knowing what the people in the cottage were like with regards to protecting the estate. We went exploring the outhouses and found a lot of creepy stuff. Kids' clothing, crayons, old moldy porno mags, and some blood stains, though the blood stains are definitely most likely from animals when the estate was still actively a farm. After this we traveled northish towards a wooded area through crop fields. It was spring, so the grass wasn't tall enough yet to be all signs style. Coincidentally, Charlie was never allowed in the fields when the wheat was at its highest. I'm with Charles, Ed and Tomo, another good friend, but a major druggie, Hess dead now, OD'd in Grimsby a year back. Roughly 100 meters from the woods we hear a fox cry, not unusual, but it was followed by barking and shouting. Fox hunting has been illegal for a few years now, so we're all engaged in super vigilante mode and start jogging towards the sound to see some country bumpkins getting man erections from hunting a fox with a pack of hounds and all his buddies. Charles is an avid supporter of fox hunting, country boy though. It's very dark, so we can't see anything distinguishable in the distance, just shadows. We start crouching through the slightly tall crop field, until we're about 60 meters away from a group of people. They number about 10-ish, there's a break in the clouds and the moonlight illuminated the scene better. There's a few on horses, but the pack have stopped. We're all watching with bated breath, even Charles. Some guy dismounts and takes out what was either a large rag or an item of clothing, I think, rather paranoidly that it was a kid's shirt or something, and gives it to the hounds. They start going wild and run off into the woods. Now this bit is up for dispute, I could easily be wrong, and Charles denied it at the time, but me and Ed were in agreement. Tomo didn't talk much about it after, that a distinctly human kind of yelp was let out. We saw movement at the far side of the woods, at which point, unseen by us, someone fires a rifle and the movement ceases. We can see the hounds through the grass and scrub in the woods, but we can hear them barking. The blokes gallop up towards the woods and we hear clapping and such. Me and Ed pull out our phones, convinced we've seen a murder. Charles assures us it's a fox hunt. Tomo, through all of the speeds, roll a massive joint and starts creeping off back to the house. Me and Ed meekishly follow and we don't talk about it again. When we left, Charles and Tomo went separately, me and Ed together. Early morning we pass a car towing a horse box. Both of us are still suitably angry at Charles for his denial and equally as worried. He does a three-point turn and follows the car with the horse box. We're both still a little high, but we've gone that weird intent that comes when you think you're in the right. We follow for an hour before we realize the car in front is doing the same circular circuit over and over again. This realization convinces us both to go home and forget it. I never did, obviously, given the map tenascopy had happened a few months previous to this. This was me lazily baiting someone to ask me about my experiences, but since I just want to talk about it, I'll post the only possibly skinwalker-esque thing I experienced. This has to do with my relations with an old friend of mine, who has also recently moved away. His family, who I won't name, a few of them run a large retail chain, used to own a farmhouse slash fuck off huge mansion called Langthorpe Hall. Look it up in the Doomsday Book. The site has been inhabited for 1,000 years at the minimum, and the surrounding grounds had hundreds of square feet of outhouses, barns and stables. Some cottages as well. These, I was told, were built a few hundred years ago for families who had settled down due to regular employment with the family in question. All in all, the grounds were huge, like something you'd find in Midwest America, which is hella unusual if you're English. So my friend inherited the place after his mom died. He didn't live in the mansion as it apparently cost a fortune to run, bills and everything, but he still rented out the outhouses, cottages and stables. He stayed there once a month or so to see to the estate-related business, but outside of that he never really showed any love for the place, which was very beautiful aesthetically. We went for barbecues in the summer sometimes, and in 2011 I saw him leading a horse to a paddock, which is unusual, as he rents the stables to horse owners and doesn't actually have any horses himself, from the servants' bathroom, shit you not, JPG. Anyway, when I go back down to the barbecue, I ask him if he's going to do a canter or something for us, just joking around. He laughs sarcastically and talks about something else. He only does this when I push him too far, like when I called his grandma Captain Cancer when she was, dying of cancer. So I leave it, cause I'm no longer a cunt. Obviously it's his business and he's not in the mood to discuss it. Whatever. Fast forward a few hours, I'm still awake with a few other friends smoking some D-Boy when we start to hear the horses kicking up a fuss. We already have a shotgun and go chill upstairs. His house is often targeted and staked out by burglars, anywhere of note. Think nothing more of it. The next morning I get up early-ish, like 5 a.m. or something, and I go to get my cigarettes from my car. This takes me past the paddock. There I see one of the old guys from the cottage is shoveling what I can only assume to be horse leftovers into a wheelbarrow, like a lot of that shit is piled into the barra. He stops when I start walking on the gravel driveway and looks my way, shouts, "Now then," I said something, don't remember what, got my cigarettes and went back inside. Straight away I went to my friend's room, the kid who owns the estate. Tell him his horse is dead and the old dude is clearing it up. He denies any horse was ever there. I get happy, cause I know he's lying, and I know I can get something out of him. Selling horse meat is pork or something, eh? He gets out of bed, and this is the only time he's ever raised a fist against me in anger. We're super close, brothers for all intents and purposes, and says I'll never understand country life. I laugh, obviously, though I was a bit unnerved. I push him for more information literally all morning. I only stop when the other guests start waking up. Before I leave to go home, he takes me aside and says something along the lines of, "You know what the people are like round here, they have traditions, and I'm obliged to follow them now I own this place. Please don't ask any more questions, because I don't have the answers." Corny, I know, but it was something to this effect. It still makes me nope to this day. I respect my friend for saying that to me though. And seems as how he's sold the place and moved as I have, I don't want to know what he does or doesn't know. My best guess is some semi-pagan cult thing. I know of pedophile rings for sure around the countryside, so this wouldn't shock me, or something big and nasty fucked up that horse. Big cat sightings are a well-documented occurrence round here, but even so, if a big cat kills a horse, you don't move it with a shovel and a wheelbarrow. I've heard a few tales of big nasty things fucking up cattle and stuff before, but I pay not so much attention to those. Personally, if skinwalkers were real, we'd definitely know about them. Plenty more dodgy stuff like that, by the way. A couple more stories about Langthorpe Hall I have secondhand from Charles, the aforementioned friend. Honestly, I'd like to share them. I don't talk to people about this, but over the internet with people who ain't gonna scoff at me, I feel pretty relieved. Sorry for my English, by the way. I'm pretty much self-taught, shitty inner city school, yay. Sorry about the lateness, long shift, I now work at Gap as a supervisor, woot. Related to Langther Paul. As I previously said, the place dates back 1,000 plus years, the building has been rebuilt numerous times obviously, but the basement, which is about half the side of the house, hasn't been touched much in terms of decor. Back when we were teenagers and Charlie's mom was still alive, we used to go round when she was on holiday. Strictly no visitors were allowed whilst his mom was home, and what fascinated us the most was the basement, because it had a tunnel running over to the next village, apparently built during the Hull Blitz. I wasn't too convinced by this. The property itself is about 13 to 15 miles away from town, and the tunnel would serve no purpose anyway. The village it leads to is a further few miles away. So we're talking 3 to 5 miles of tunnel leading to a village for no other reason than to run away if, in the unlikely event, the Luftwaffe dumped their bombs hilariously off target. But anyway, this time was during our urban explorer phase. We packed a bag, flashlights and me, Charles and Ed, another very good friend, went down into the basement to explore the tunnel. The basement floor was all dirt and clay, there was some wooden flooring in places, but it was mostly rotten and damp. It was creepy as fuck, but what huge dark basement isn't? You could tell where the basement had been extended. Normal reddish bricks started where older larger gray bricks rested. There were some marked engravings on the wall, nothing paranormal, just stuff like a name and a date. The oldest one was 1800 something. Pretty cool. So we start making our way down the tunnel, single file as the thing's about 5'5 high and 2 across. Very cramped for us, but fun at first. We were walking for close to 10 minutes when Charles, who's at the front, finds either a small herbivore tooth or a human tooth. How he spotted it I don't know, but we're all creaming our pants with scared-induced bravado. A little further up the tunnel had two tunnels splitting off from either side. We did not expect this. We decide to head on straight as previous and return to look down those places later. By now the floor is particularly muddy and chewed up, which set our spidey senses tingling, but here's the thing, the tunnel was going deeper. We could tell by the water level, it was becoming more and more flooded and wet. By now we're perhaps ankle deep in water, wellies are a must in country life, yo. This is when we definitely knew for sure the tunnel wasn't World War II related. When the water got to about knee high and we started getting wet, we hit a brick wall. Someone had bricked up the tunnel. We try shifting it with our legs and the bottom part gives way, leaving a pretty small gap to crawl through. None of us wanting to get wet, we decided not to go through, but I had a peek through with my flashlight. It led into a bigger chamber. I couldn't see much of anything, the light just kept going till it landed on nothing. We all reckon catacombs. Suitably freaked out and happy with our discovery, we turn back. When we get to the two tunnels either side of us, we elect to go into the one on our left. What followed was at least 3 hours of tunnel crawling. My phone died pretty soon, as did Ed's and Charles, so it could have been longer. By that point we all had heinous back pain from the crouching, and our feet were numb from the wetness of before. The tunnel we followed never split off, but it did change directions a fair bit, which was odd. On our way out I shat myself hard. After we got back to the original tunnel I was at the rear. I was the first to realize there was something, or something was disturbing the water behind us. Could have been rats, could have been badgers. But it shat us up all good. We ran as fast as we could given the space. We were gonna go back but Ed wussed out, which secretly relieved me. We didn't see Charles for a few weeks after that. Ed said his mom picked him up from school and dropped him off, dinner as well. I went to a shitty school and they went to a private. He'd been grounded for going in the tunnel. How his mom knew, and why it was a big deal we couldn't fathom, but of course, knowing what I know now about all these weird disconcerting incidents, I'm definitely glad she's dead. Harsh I know, but some people are up to weird shit, and in the country, particularly one so socially isolated as rural East Yorkshire, it's easy to do just about whatever you want. Something like 7 people go missing a day round here according to some local rag. Make of that what you will.